Well, my friends, before we start, one announcement. If someone shouts fire, then please clear the aisles and Mr. Faruqi can leave first. Well, it's my great pleasure today to be amongst you and Mr. Faruqi asking him questions about one of the great new books of Indian literature. It just means that you cannot say anything as an aside because. So I'm here today with Mr. Faruqi, who's written The Mirror of Beauty twice over. I mean, a very few Indian writers have written a great novel twice over. And he wrote it first in Urdu a few years ago and in English recently. It just come out. And I also have a formidable cast of co-conspirators, all of whom are part of the book at some point. Mr. Faruqi's daughter Meher and his grandson Sahil. And yes. I did mean to say that too. But sir, we'll start with you first. Please, everyone knows, as knew you as, and we were just chatting before the event started, and you said it was an unusual experience for you to be on the red. You've written the first novel in the 70s, but obviously you had a full life in literature before this as one of the best known names in Urdu writing. So will you please tell us a little bit about how you came to write this book and how many years it took, and especially the Urdu side of it, which we all of us have read in English, most of us have presumed. So everyone is a bit curious to know about its past in another language.
Well, actually, the novel came by accident. But it was like a suppressed child somewhere, right deep in my psyche for years and years and years. Because when I was growing up and when I began writing, there was in very small, 8 years, 9 years old. At that time, the great name went to be Richard, but all were like that. They were in the top, he had
Can't hear.
So these names are household names for us. Leaders of Urdu literature, Krishna Chandra, for example, or and then of course Subhanana Kashi and Devi and of course another came later, but she already became quite famous and well known. So I mean to say that the horizon was kind of cluttered up with fictionalizers. And one of my most thrilling moments was when, as a schoolboy, I saw a translation in English of Krishnendra's book, Chole or Phool, Fire and Flowers. So it was a great moment for me that, well, here is a writer in Urdu who can be recognized as an English writer also, or who can be translated in English also. But before us, of course, there was Ahmad Ali, long ago, he was in the deep in the history somewhere. And he wrote only one novel, so he just about knew about him, but we never really took him as a part of our current scene. These people who were not much older or much younger than the Ahmad Ali, they were there all the time, they were before us, you mean, before my eyes, before my consciousness. So I also had ambition to start my literary life as a writer of fiction. And I wrote some stories, most of them were published. Some of them did get published, for which I can't thank God. I wrote a small short novel at the age of 15. I wrote a short novel which had a funny name, Daldal Se Bahar, out of the quagmire. So, I mean, in that novel, the guy knew everything about life. How people are born, how people die, what kind of bad things are happening to us, what is sin, what is redemption. So it was a short novel, fortunately. It got a single publication in a magazine called Mayar in here. I was in Gorakhpur at the time. And thank God, no manuscript exists. No copy exists. But I do claim to have been the author of this novel, or novel. Or novel, because it represents my authenticity and my identity as a novelist. It's not that I just, it's not like I throw the ball. You better by yourself, come on, sit down, let's do it. So, that particular guy, the little boy who was trying to come out all the time and tell me stories, but he remained suppressed. He remained actually in Kuchaldi. He was downtrodden, completely smashed and squashed. Because when I grew up, I began reading English, Urdu, I never did school, Urdu and Parsi, I had at home. I have the I can claim to medical history, but wisdom is all that I have, by the way, my gladness, my qualities. But then gradually it happened that I became a writer. I became a sort of a well-known, and if you don't mind, I think a well-clear writer. Before the English was so trenchant and so clear. Anyway, again an occasion arose when I had to write something about Gali. And I was compiling a valid issue for my magazine in 1997, on the 200% of the valid. Everybody was writing something and other. So as you know, I was about the magazine in Urdu. So I got some people to write something about valid. And there were very, very, very well known names in Persian and Urdu. But after the about 18 months effort, all that I got was just, excuse my saying, so professorial writing. The writing written by professor, which are full of platitudes and these are well-known facts and all. The best thing that I got was by a guy called Krishna Mohan, who at that time was a PhD scholar in Allahabad, and who knows, who had of course learned the language sort of by hearing and by practicing. And it was the best paper on Ghalib that I got at that time. So justice demanded that paper, even though it's written by a Hindi writer of a younger generation, much younger than mine, and so on, should go first, because my quality has always been to merit first, not the name. So then I thought this will be really, this will create a protest, that I'm putting senior professors who are about to die, putting them above a person who has just been born. So, I said, Asha, this is Karnataka. Why not write a story about Ghalib? Well, Ghalib is a person who is so colorful. And he is the one about whom we know so much, much more than almost any other writer. Or even a modern writer. So I wrote a story about Ghalib, but I began it with my home village, or near my home village, Adamgarh, Nizamabad, a small place there. So, and I wove into it also the story of the Hindu family who were caught in the maelstrom of the revolution. How they faced their revolution, what happened to them, and how this man survived with the lover of Ghalib and so forth. So, much of it is about that person and that Hindu family, some of whom also are actually Muslim, but there were some Darbar at some time. He became Muslim, but then they remained friends and all that. So the rest of it is about Ghalib, and that part is absolutely authentic in the sense that it is based on exactly what Ghalib wrote in his letter. So it came out as a sort of a strange kind of evocation of it. And the person, the protagonist, he promises to come to Ghalib again. Ghalib also wants him to come again, but he's so young and so interesting and so. So fourth like in practice, being from the place in very near Bihar, he is very forthright. So he even takes the courage to meet Ghalib on certain. Anyway, he never goes back. And that I think is the real story. That he worshipped him when he was small, he actually got to see him and stay with him and meet with him and talk to him. He never went back. So this is what he writes in 1918 at the end of the First World War, his first action, and says that, well, Angrez fought such a big country war and was almost brilliant, but then he won. So stranger God says, I don't know why it happened with me, I've been alive so long. And to remember Ghalib and to remember my grandfather and my father and my, and the story of those days when he ran away. Fight and then killed. So that story I wrote under the name of the protagonist, Benny Madhur Swar. And that name was picked up by my from a small pool of names that I produced. I wrote there, and I asked the child to pick up one of those names. So she picked up his name, Benny Madhur Swar. So practically everyone believed that it was an old manuscript somewhere that we had discovered, and we had put it here. So that sort of made me realize that, look, it was 1999 when I was, how old was that time? I won't be able to tell you.
You shouldn't reveal.
65, I think. Maybe she was 65. I said, well, if I, at the age of 64, in 1999, I can write a story which is the longest story and which can carry conviction with people, of all kinds of people, and which contains things I love for, have been loving all my life, our past history, our Indo-Muslim connection, our interpenetration of two cultures, and how they were irrigated each other and made them grow. And then, of course, the Ghalib, the towering personality of the 20th century. So if I can do that, I can do more.
Actually, one of the it's always wonderful when you read fiction and then suddenly in this entire fictive setup, a historical personage emerges, like in Gandhi and Aki Narayan's work. And I think one of the very best chapters in this book is when Wazir Khan and suddenly sees Ghalib appear for the first time. Ghalib, living Ghalib in the present moment of the novel. But of course, what is sometimes not clear to us as English readers is that, I mean, you must have written your novel out of an awareness of what is going on in the Urdu novel of that union in the last 40-50 years. And would you like to say something very quickly before Sahil reads a bit from the book about the world of the Urdu novel that some English readers might not know, from which you observed so closely and from which you wrote your book?
Well, I told you something about the beginning of my town, my literary life. That is the very early 40s and 1940s. When the Urdu novel was, there was hardly a Urdu novel, it's a proclamation. But everything was saturated with the sense of what they called the social relevance of it. How socially relevant are you? Are you politically aware or not? If you are politically aware, then which politics are you aware of? So, and on whose side you are? All those questions, you know? And this whole sort of popery was kind of worked up into a storm by the progressives. They came and said, look, you fellows are not at all interested in the human life. You have no interest in the poor people, in the working class. You have no idea of history. You have no idea of how history creates these things and how we have to fight them, and so forth. So that writing, although it completely, entirely fascinated me, and of course it was all different kind of writing all the time. It's not that everybody was saying the same thing. But basically they're all telling us to be socially aware, to be politically aware. Even Bedi Sahib was more interested in person, and Manto Sahib was more interested in the situation. He was telling us, look at the life around you and write about it. And then say, who is suffering? And why is he suffering? Why are they suffering? And why should they not suffer? Why should they suffer at all? Why should they not share the good qualities and the happiness of life that other people have? So that did not appeal to me as a writer. But I didn't want to take sides of that guy. Because although, anyway, I won't go into more into it. I grew up. Now it is 17 and I have a whole generation of writers who are known as the people of the 60s. Of whom I am supposed to be the leader and the Marsh and the misleader and so forth. So we brought out different kinds of fiction, abstract fiction, fiction close to prose poems, fiction where the characters are not known, what things happening and where we are not very clear about. But there is a whole sense of hope, there is a whole sense of mystery and power. And I wrote a story of that type myself under the name of in that story, which I was forced to shamelessly copy from VA, there is a murder that takes place. And the story is narrated by two persons in heaven. One is the murderer and one is the murderee. So how does the murderer do it and how does the murderee feel about it? So which is a very forced shamelessly do a roman. I don't know anything from human that. But I mean I also did that. That I have told these people that look, you are free to write whatever you want to write. You subvert the time sequence, 5 may come before 9, 20 may not come at all, there will be 19 and 19 all the time. You are free now. Don't please think about social, political sides and changes and whose side are you on, whether you are on the side of the truth or. But you question what the truth is. So some young writers came out like Abdullah Hussain in Pakistan, who wrote an excellent novel about him. He also lived in English Travelogue and Abdullah Hussain. It's about the free freedom struggle. Just about that time, he was growing up in Pakistan. Then in Pakistan, there's the second world war in Pakistan. And how lives have changed so much. And not in the routine, routine riots, the Hindu-Muslim riot sense, but in the real sense, how life has changed when the countries have been divided. So that became an outstanding novel of my generation, Gulaab Hasan, where it was over. And of course, he took more care to write good Urdu than anything else. He was not keen on sort of injecting information and views and ideas into the world. He wanted to inject just poetry. So that is how what I saw before me, what I saw before me. I didn't want to write like Abdullah Hussain, but still, I mean, I knew that yes, different kinds of fiction can be written now. And possibilities have arisen, and possibilities are now open to us, depending on how much talent we have, how much genuine commitment we have to fiction and to Urdu.
Okay, why don't we have? Your family is very well covered for different kinds of interpretations of the material you've written, and Mehr, of course, I know, and I'm going to ask her shortly about how you, what it was like to be living in the same household when the book was being written. But before that, I thought that Sahil, who's your grandson, is going to give a reading from the work, a dramatic reading. And we're going to finish with that, and then he's going to read a bit from a particular chapter, and then we'll get back to it.
Can I read it with the mic or not?
I hold it.
Sahil Padaji, and I'm Sampriya Manpadaji's grandson. I'll be reading a little selection from The Mirror of Beauty. It's from chapter 32. And this is when the main character, Wazir Khanam, is going to visit Nawab Shamsuddin Ahmad Khan. Wazir had again borrowed a carriage for the occasion. It was the personal buggy of Nawab Yusuf Ali Khan, made of teak wood imported from the Irrawaddy River Valley. It was pulled by two white horses. Its doors were painted light blue, and in order to eliminate any chance of breach of purdah, they were lined with thick brocade curtains and fully shut. The ceiling and the wheels were painted cream white. The horses wore plumes made of ostrich feathers and those of the colorful Himalayan peasant called Nan. They wore mouthpieces of golden silk netting. Their tails had ornaments of golden silk tassels, and their blinkers were made of white buckskin. Strips of rhinoceros hide, twisted to resemble a strong rope, were used for their reins. On the coach box, Wazir had a staff bearer traveling by the side of the coachman. When the buggy stopped at the stairs leading up to the outer veranda of the Nawab's Haveli, the staff bearer vaulted down with alacrity and knocked softly on the buggy's door. As the door opened and the curtain moved, the staff bearer promptly fixed wooden steps onto the door sill. Wazir descended, not deigning to look to her right or left, and set foot on the bottom step of the veranda. She climbed up slowly and deliberately, with her foot on the third step as if to be sure-footed. She had hardly put her third step when the Nawab's doorkeeper spoke up in careful, measured tone. The presence. Wazir Khanam Sahib's noble feet are here. By now, Wazir had negotiated the last step. Nawab Shamsuddin Ahmad Khan, too impatient to wait any longer, left the inside of the crown door and, opening the bigger outer door, opened his arms wide as if to embrace her. Wazir raised her eyes a little. A brief smile touched her mouth and face. Stopping where she was, she bent and made a salaam. Then she looked at him full in the face with an effort of will, but spoke shyly. May God preserve the Nawab Sahib and keep him always secure. Your honor took so much trouble for me, who am nothing before you. I drip the sweat of shame. Having said this, she lowered her eyes again. It would indeed take some time to traverse the veranda, which was about 12 to 15 feet wide. And this time, the Nawab also realized that Wazir's gait was feather-light and full of elegance, and yet it seemed so commanding, sovereign-like, that the very ground seemed to spread before her in welcoming submission. By now, Shamsuddin Ahmad had fully put his position near the outer door, and meeting her halfway, he put his arm around her waist and led her towards the crown door. "God must have sent down some angels to teach you how to walk," he said. "We ordinary mortals cannot walk with such grace." "Ah well," Nimat finally says, quote, "the way she looks at things, her eye lays the foundation of gardens wherever she walks. The impressions of her feet scatter fresh roses in her path." Quote. Wazir found herself in a double bind. She was no longer the 14-year-old beauty of 6 years ago, unthinking and uncaring, drunk with the desire of being loved and taken with the emotional need for love and adventure. Nor was Shamsuddin Ahmad, in spite of all the physical and mental appeal he had for Wazir, and all the manners promising to be the comfort for Wazir's heart. That strange, novel, mysterious ocean of love whose waves had drenched Wazir from the very first day in the form of the gestures and hints of the Firangi, Mastern Lake. Numerous highs and lows of living, coupling and pairing, owning a home and managing a family had passed over her since she impulsively left home. Now, she was unwilling to plunge, with closed or even open eyes, into the sea of loving and love, however easy of approach and amenable to her feet it might have seemed to her before the actual deed. But the burning question, the overwhelming question, was the very first that Wazir's heart had asked her. What did the words "imprisonment for life" mean to Shamsuddin Ahmad? The Nawab was now looking at her with patient and expectant eyes. During the past half hour or so, the curtain on one of the doors had moved briefly once or twice. Perhaps the servants wanted to know how much time it would be before the command to serve dinner might be issued. But both of them, host and guest, were lost in the world of their own. Neither had any insight how to get out of their prison. Wazir said to herself, "Wazir, darling, do something towards your purpose. This is the world of each to herself." The voice in her heart was so loud that she paled for a moment, fearful that Nawab might have heard her. She reached a sudden decision and rose. Nawab almost lost his cool and his power of reasoning for a heartbeat or two. "What is this? What happened here?" And then a wave of displeasure, sharp and quick, ran through him. Would Choti Begum be so important as to rise in this fashion without taking permission or concluding their dialogue? He was about to shift from his place and rise or say something when Wazir Khanum folded her hands in the manner of the people of Lucknow when they wish to be humble and said, "It was on that day, the very first day, that I accepted you in my heart as my master, my prince, my friend. But you stand in need of nothing and I am a beggar. It is your boundless generosity and your loving inclination towards me that you demand me from my own self, and that too by declaring me rich and extending the begging bowl in my direction. Despite being the giver of rewards, you play the loving game of appearing before me in the disguise of one who asks for favors. This servant is already sold over to you at no price, and is willing to live all her life, ever seeing your name on her rosary." But the Nawab now half rose from his place and cried, "But for what? What else do you demand from me, Wazir Khanum? Is there a let or hindrance in your heart about me? Do you doubt me in some way? If not, what should I understand you to mean by your declaration to live your whole life saying my name alone? And should you not think about how long one can live and how much can be the real duration of the few days of life that we are given?" The Nawab now rose to his full height, took a step nearer to Wazir Khanum, gently put his right arm around her waist. Equally softly, he tried to pull her to his side and was about to kiss her when Wazir took a step backwards, folded her hands on her breast and said, "Your Honor,
Everything that I have is yours. Were I asked to sacrifice everything that I have, including my life for you, I would cross that river with a smile on my face and pleasure in my heart. I can be yours even if you and I were to live our lives alone and separately. I would boast about my good fortune if your honor desires to take me in his golden shade. Yet, if the presence were to tarry a little and give some thought to the matter, I would regard that as the greatest favor. At that time, the Nawab saw a luminance, a sort of pride and self-control that he was obliged to describe to himself as the power of her inner self, if not the power of her soul. He tried to look Wazir in the eye, but was unable to stand the incandescence radiating from her face. He lowered his eyes and said,
"Choti Begum, I'm not sure if there's anything left to say. Still, please command. I'm all ears." Thank you.
Well, you just heard Sahil reading from left to right. Many videos and these are the Urdu from right to left.
I'm not a trained reader of texts. On my side, of course, is the beautiful Urdu. So I'm going to be reading a short section of the Urdu, what Sahil has delivered in English. Yeah, you'll see that there are some differences. And I'm not going to read the whole passage either, because I'll just do a little bit. Yes, but not the whole thing.
Some omissions that he had made and it's not really not. You will see your version.
Oh, you see. Wazir us din Nawab Yusuf Ali Khan ki baghi mein baith kar aayi thi. Irawadi ke saagwan ki baghi thi. उसमें दो सफेद घोड़े जुटे हुए थे और उसके हल्के नीले रंग के दरवाजे ऊंचे और पूरी तरह बंद थे। ऊंचाई के एतबार से बग्घी आमतौर पर बहली, बैलगाड़ी और रथ से कोई 6 अंगुल ज्यादा ऊंची होती थी। बेपर्दगी के इम्कान को बिल्कुल खत्म करने की गरज से दरवाजों के पीछे अंदर की तरफ भारी कमखाब के पर्दे भी लटकाए गए थे। बग्घी की छत और पहिए मलाई के रंग के थे। घोड़ों की कलगियां शुतुरमुर्ग और मोनाल के परों की थीं। उनके बदन पर रेशमी कूजियां और सुनहरी झालर की दुमचियां, सफेद हिरन की खाल की अंधेरियां या चश्मबंद और गेंदे के खाल की जंजीरें थीं जिन्हें घूम कर इनानों की शक्ल दे दी गई थी। बाहर की नशिस्त पर बहलवान के साथ वजीर ने किराए का एक सोटा बरदार बिठा लिया था। बग्घी नवाब शमसुद्दीन की सीढ़ियों से लगकर ठहरी तो मान सोटा बरदार अपनी नशिस्त से कूद कर नीचे आया। उसने बग्घी के दरवाजे पर मुअद्दबाना दस्तक दी। दरवाजा अंदर से खुला, पर्दा हटा। सोटा बरदार ने एक छोटी सीढ़ी बग्घी की चौखट से अटका ली। सीढ़ी लगते ही उसकी सवारी का दाया पांव बाहर निकला और सोटा बरदार की आंखें चकाचौंध हो गईं। उसने बेइख्तियार चाहा कि अपना हाथ बढ़ा कर उतरने के लिए सहारा दे, लेकिन दूसरे ही पल वजीर ने दूसरा पांव बाहर निकाला। सोटा बरदार ने बिजली की सी कौन महसूस करके घबरा कर कदम पीछे हटा लिए। वजीर एक अंदाजे बेइत्मीनानी से उतरी और हवेली की सीढ़ियां चढ़ने लगी। निगाहें झुकाए हुए वो या सीढ़ियों पर अपने पांव मजबूत जमाना चाहती हो। उसने दूसरी सीढ़ी पर कदम रखा ही था कि नवाब के दरबार में मुअद्दब मुख्तार लेकिन बुलंद आवाज में ठहर ठहर कर ऐलान किया, हुजूर वजीर खानम साहब तशरीफ लाती हैं। अब तक वजीर आखिरी सीढ़ी चढ़कर बरामदे पर दाखिल हो चुकी थी। नवाब शमसुद्दीन अहमद बेताबाना ताजदार दरवाजा छोड़कर बाहरी दरवाजे पर आए। उसके दोनों पाटों पर उसके दोनों किवाड़ पाटों पर खोलकर आगोश इख्तियार को भी वार कर दिया। वजीर की आंखें कुछ उठी, इसके चेहरे पर जरा सा तबस्सुम आया। उसने वहीं से झुककर तस्लीम की और नवाब से नजरें मिलाकर लेकिन हया से भरपूर लहजे में कहा, अल्लाह नवाब साहब को सलामत रखे, इस नाचीज के लिए सरकार ने इस कदर जहमत की, मैं अरब अरब हुई जाती हूँ। ये कहकर उसने निगाहें झुका ली लेकिन नवाब की तरफ बढ़ती रही। निगाह मिलाकर बात करना उसने मार्शल ब्लेक से सीखा था। कई बार की गलत फहमी और झुंझलाहटों के बाद उस पर यह बात मुंतशिफ हुई थी कि फिरंगी लोग निगाहें फेर कर या झुका कर बात करने वालों को दगाबाज या बेईमान समझते हैं। हालांकि हिंदी तहजीब में था कि बड़ों से, अजनबियों से, करीबी अजीजों से आंख मिलाकर बात नहीं करनी चाहिए, लेकिन आहिस्ता आहिस्ता उसने खुद को समझा लिया था कि आंखों में आंखें डालकर गुफ्तगू न सही, निगाह रूबरू रखना वो दरबार शाहाना के भी आदाब में शामिल है। फिर यहाँ भी क्या मुजायका है कि अहम बातें करते वक्त मद्दे मुकाबिल के चेहरे पर निगाह पड़ती रहे। बारह चौदह हाथ का बरामदा तय करने में कुछ वक्त तो लगता ही था और इस बार फैनी पास की तरह नवाब ने भी महसूस कर लिया कि वजीर की चाल कुछ ऐसी हल्की लताफत से भरपूर लेकिन कैदादियों वाली थी कि लगता था जमीन इसके आगे बिछी चली जा रही हो। शमसुद्दीन अहमद अब दरवाजे से पूरी तरह बाहर आ गए। उन्होंने झुक कर तस्वीर की और हिम्मत करके वजीर की कमर में हाथ डालकर उसे सदर दरवाजे की तरफ ले चले। अल्लाह ताला ने कोई फरिश्ता भेजा होगा कि आपको चलना सिखाए, ऐसी चाल जैसे मामूली इंसानों की नहीं हो सकती। नेमत खान आली ने क्या खूब कहा है, रंग गुलशन बज़मी तर्ज निगाहश रेज़द, नक्श पा बर्ग गुले ताज़ा बराहश रेज़द। नवाब हुजूर, मुझे कांटों में ऐंठते हैं, मुझे अपनी कनीज शुमार करें, यहाँ आकर तो यूं ही मेरा दम फूला जाता है। अल्लाह ये दीवान आली शान और मैं भला यहाँ क्यों कर फंस सकूँगी, यही सोच सोच कर हलकान हो जाते हैं।
Mayor, after listening to you read that, I can begin to see why your father wrote such a long book, so you'd never run out of the pleasures of you reading different pages. Mr. Farooqi, I meant to ask you though, there's one way in which your novel shares something with the early Indian novels of the 19th century, in that you choose very deliberately to make your protagonist a woman who then travels up and down between the various layers and worlds of society. And you have a complete view of her society through her various prevails with men, with servants, with the domestic and the public sphere. But it's very daring of you to write a text set primarily in the heart of a woman who dares to say to the world, I will first taste the man who wants me. Why didn't you tell us a bit about Wazir Khanam and how you wrote up a character?
Right. Actually, Wazir Khanam is a historical character. All the important events that I have narrated here in her life, they really happened. Now, if they happened, the way I wrote them is my fault. But they certainly happened. And I tried to make them happen in my head as the way they would have happened then. And there's a small change in which I won't go into. Now, another thing which Chandra has said, which I really, pardon my saying so, is a kind of cliche now. The Urdu novel begins with a courtesan, with a dancing girl, with a naughty girl, namely Pungrao Janaka. And the Farooqi Saab has done the same. And in fact, Inzaur Hussain, my great friend and one of the most well-loved writers today in Urdu fiction, in his review, he said many years ago that this novel had created the same kind of hulchal, the same kind of, you can say, tumult and disturbance as the Kumaral Jan had done in his time, 100 years ago and more. But I don't agree with that. This is not a novel about a woman who is a fallen woman and how she falls and how she tries to rise. Of course, I am familiar with Dina Oldenburg's work on the Courses of Lucknow, and it's a very, very illuminating work and I've learned a lot from it. That it was the choice of being a courtesan or a dancing girl or whatever, was actually it was an empowerment, not always of Majguri. But I'm not going to tell you or write about that. I am writing about a historical figure. Remember that. This is how things happened for her. Now, why did they happen for her? That I have tried to explain. And of course, the idea that there could be women of that type, of that, as you very nicely bring out it, main mard ko chakhungi, pasand aayega to rakhungi, yahi to nikal baar karungi. Now, in 1820, 1822, a Muslim girl saying this, and not a courtesan, but she's a Chowal Sharif family. So there could be women like that, and there were women like that at that time. Both among Hindus, among Muslims, there were women like that who chose for themselves, who left their husband, a princess of the royal family of Delhi, was married to one of the royal family, so-called royal family of Lucknow. I just forgot that they were very king. They became king because of the marriage. So she didn't like him, and it was a marriage of politics, because a man never considered the marriage at all. He wanted to take revenge or something else to Delhi. So she ran away. She left him, publicly left him, and went to the Nangres, and the famous Gardner family of the Western Union. So things have happened like this. It's not that I am creating a woman out of my dirty imagination. There were people like that. Now, of course, each person is different. It's not that everybody is this Anam. Not that everybody is that Begum who ran away from the Nawabi Mahal of Lucknow. So each of them have their own lives to live, have their own ways to understand what they are doing. The main thing that I did here was that, of course, this was Munajanala is not the first Urdu novel. Please remember that. Some people say it's the first modern Urdu novel. I don't know what modern means in context, but anyway, there have been novels in Urdu written by women and men both in the 19th century. I know whether they are moralistic novels or they are dialectic novels, but they are novels in any case. Anyway, my point is that people ask me to write about Dal, her son, because he has been a colorful character and was the last great classical writer in history. And I knew what Dal, of course, even I admired him, I written about him, and I knew what his mother also, but when I began to think about the whole situation, how Da was born and how it happened, I found that this woman was 1,000 times more full of character, not only colorfulness, full of character, than anyone could have been. And so, and it's not that some people say that this is a feminist novel, or this is the first feminist novel, my daughter, not this one, younger person, this is the first feminist novel. And Kishwar Nair, the famous Urdu writer who is also feminist in Lahore, he said, "Nahi, wo shaadi ho karna chahti hai." So she is not a real feminist. But that's how she was. I don't say she was a feminist. I say she wants to make her life. And when Master Lake offers her marriage, or the hint that he will marry her now, she undergoes a long, long turmoil, a travail of knowledge and meaning of inner introspection. So I really found that in this country, always benighted and always maligned and always kicked by the so-called Sadhguru Tamliwala, who were there, kindly excuse me and forgive me, that we are all benighted, we are all ghazals, we don't know what women are, we never respected them, we treated them only as good as devil. Maybe not, but history or life is not so semi-colored and not so unique as we want to make it. And here are the examples.
I was very interested when you said a bit earlier that you admired Abdullah Hussain because he was Guru Urdu. And I wonder what you exactly make of this book. You want to explain what Guru Urdu means in a novelistic context. Especially because in the book we have many layers of language, and you see that some people don't speak Urdu so well, so many will learn Hindi. Wazir himself becomes a teacher, learns English and is trying to teach Urdu to Marcin Day. So, and then there's a higher register of Guru Urdu, which is the poetry that you keep on putting in the book, of which there's a lot. So, would you want to talk a little bit about the language of the book? And what do you think of as Guru Urdu?
Yes, that's a very good question. Because we have been burdened and overburdened and broken back by the concept of poetic Urdu or poetic prose. And jab tak ki usme aap guzar gayi kuch aahwan na banke aaye ab kya ho gaya are bibi are bibi tum kahan chali gayi thi ae dekho na tumhare liye dada ne aap mere इधर सुना देते मैंने कि ओ बरसात हो गई हा 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 दिन हो रहा है कोयल बोल रही है वो देखो आम के पेड़ में देखो भैया ये पोएट्री पोएट्री नहीं है वो तो बोल रहा दूसरी बात नॉट पोएट्री तो हमारे यहाँ के जो बहुत ही वेल रेस्पेक्टेड राइटर हैं लोग हैं तो हम तो अपनी बहुत छोटी थी हम भी उनसे बहुत छोटे थे और उत्तरायण हैदर उनको मैंने बहुत बुरा भला कहा कि आप क्या लिख रही हैं यू आर राइटिंग थर्ड रेट पोएट्री इन एवर प्रोज तो वो बहुत बहुत से मुझसे बहुत नाराज थी बहुत ही नाराज थी तो वो जो कॉन्सेप्ट था कि आप पोइट्री उर्दू में लैंग्वेज प्रोज में ऐसा आना चाहिए दैट शुड फ्लो इट शुड ऑल विद गोल्डन क्वालिटीज एंड द सनसेट ग्लो एंड द मॉर्निंग ग्लो ये वो नहीं अब्दुल्ला हुसैन ग्रेट ग्रेट पॉइंट दैट ही सीज थिंग्स उसके पहले इवन प्रेमचंद ने सी सी थिंग्स ओवर एज फूल के रंग को फूल की पंखड़ी को पत्ती को पौधों को आदमी की आवाज़ों को आदमी के लहजे को आदमी की शक्ल को द वे ही सीज एंड वेरी ऑफन आई फील दैट दिस मैन इज राइटिंग इन इंग्लिश इज दैट एंड वी कैन रीड इन उर्दू देख रहा हूं तो हमारे यहां था ही नहीं हमारे यहां तो दैट्स अ होल लवली क्वेश्चन दैट व्हाट इज व्हाट इज मेंट बाय सीइंग बट आई डोंट गो टू दैट but in modern prose this question has to be dealt what are you seeing and what are you looking at is every woman a woman is every woman a Layla and every lover a Majnu then you are writing a novel so Abdullah Hussain struck me that way and of course he has his own layers and graces and I didn't like his English translation I mean in Urdu, he is certainly a very striking person. He strikes you as a person who is writing Urdu fiction from the point of view of the human eye. How things are, how things go, how things look.
Mehr, before you read us a little bit again, because I do think that everyone would like to hear a little bit more. Why don't you tell us a little bit about what it was like to be in the same household as the Mirror of Beauty while it was coming into life?
Well, I wasn't exactly, I was in living in Islamabad, but Mirror of Beauty was things with me, because by then I had moved to the US and I was teaching at the University of Virginia. But I came home for long visits, so I was here. Part of the time, but I would actually want to share with you how it was when I was a little girl growing up in Islamabad, when my parents were sort of the leaders of this immense movement known as Jadidiyat or modernism in Urdu literature, and my father was launching this journal called Shabkun, Night Attack. And I was sitting like 5 years old, and our dwelling room was always full of writers and poets, and they would be discussing all kinds of things, and I would just, you know, pick up a word here or there, and I would, and it always stayed with me. And it's so, this kind of imbibing the living tradition of what it meant as Urdu moved from its classical to its modern phase, served me very well when I became a teacher and a professor. I was about 2 years old when I could recite Ghalib and Mir, and that was because my father took great pains to teach me how to memorize those verses
and pronounce them
correctly with the right intonation. And I didn't really understand the meaning of it, obviously, because there was one shared Ulti ho gayi sab tadbeerein kuch na dawa ne kaam kiya.
देखा इस बीमारी दिन में आपने काम तमाम किया तो I just followed Jio Wings, all the things were vomited out. I had this very, very, so I had very colorful ideas about all those shares. And when I grew up and naturally I understood the word meaning, and I've written about it too. So it was, my childhood was very, very fascinating and very rich. And I'm really indebted. I want to remember my mother at this moment because if she had been here with us, it would have been, you know, she would have been so proud of seeing the three of us sitting here talking to you all at the Jaipur Lit Festival. I'm sure she is with us in spirit because she was the guiding, she was the moving force behind my father's immense accomplishments as a writer because she made it, she made the household run so perfectly, and it wasn't like she was just a homebody. She was a principal of a girls' college, and so she was a professional. And both of us, my sister and I, we were always, you know, she encouraged us to be educated, not just by, you know, getting high marks in school, which we did, but also to be aware of who we were in the moment that we were living, you know, as the daughter of the Guru Maharaj and all those things. So she inculcated in us pride in being who we were and living in Allahabad, which was the home of all these writers. I mean, it was just the most marvelous place. And I'm presently also working on a project on Allahabad in the 1930s where it was said that even if you threw a pebble, it was going to hit someone very important. So, yes, I mean, anyone was there, whether it was in politics or in literature. So, I can read another passage from the book because...
Was she in love with Marston Blake Moore or was she in love with Shamsuddin? I don't know. And what did Marston bring?
I like her
that Shamsuddin did not.
I don't know. And
I wouldn't tell you.
You can tell us.
Tell them, please.
Well, my friends, I hope we're running out of time, but hope you've enjoyed meeting the remarkable family behind a remarkable book. We would now open up to questions, a few questions.
Please give me
the
mic. Is there a mic?
No, just shout.
I will point people out so there's no confusion, and we can just take one by one. You at the back there.
Yes, sir. I have a question.
Please keep your question.
Lovely.
Please keep your question a bit short.
आपने उर्दू में लिखा हुआ सर, तो आज के नौजवान लोग सर उर्दू में लिखना चाहते हैं लेकिन वो इनसिक्योर फील करते हैं कि हमारा फ्यूचर क्या होगा इसमें, मुस्तकबिल से डरते हैं सर, तो आपको क्या लगता है सर इस बारे में, हमें लिखना चाहिए या
नहीं? तो बहुत रूटीन क्वेश्चन, बहुत पुराना हो मैं दोषी नहीं हूँ कोई, ये सवाल मुझसे लोग 50 साल से पूछ रहे हैं, 50 साल से जवाब दे रहा हूँ, मतलब आई एम नॉट दोषी, आई कैन नॉट से व्हाट विल हैपन टुमारो, लेकिन आज अगर तुम उर्दू में लिखना चाहते हो तुम्हारे पास तमाम दरवाजे खुले हुए हैं, अब सोच लिया तुमने बहुत खराब लिख रहे अपॉर्चुनिटी कभी नहीं, नो लैक अपॉर्चुनिटी, तुम्हें परमिशन मिल जाएगा, तुम्हें पढ़ने वाले मिल जाएंगे, मैगजीन वगैरह में छापने वाले मिल जाएंगे, तुम्हारे बारे में तारीफ करने वाले मिल जाएंगे, तुम चाहो तो ऐसा नहीं, उर्दू का फ्यूचर जो पास जो कुछ था वो था छोड़ दिया, लेकिन उर्दू का जो फ्यूचर अब उर्दू इन दिस कंट्री एटलीस्ट द प्रेजेंट इज बेटर देन द पास्ट, अब वो जो ब्राह्मण साहब हम लोगों से कहा गए थे कि ग्रो ओल्ड अलॉन्ग विद मी, द बेस्ट इज येट टू बी, द लास्ट ऑफ लाइफ अब इज द फर्स्ट वन मेड, तो एक हद तक वो सही है इस बारे में कि द बेस्ट इज येट टू बी, लेकिन जो अभी है वो ऐसा ब्लीक नहीं है, इट्स नॉट सो ब्लीक एंड डार्क एज इट कैन नो इन द फ्यूचर.
Yes, you want your question.
There are two ladies who have been rather keen to
hear.
Mahmoud Sahab, आपका राजस्थान के संसद में बहुत मेहमान था और मैं बड़ी मुश्किल से आपको सुन रहा था, आपसे रब्ता भी कायम रहा है. मेरा सवाल ये है दुनिया की तौर पर कि संक्रमण फारूकी को हम शेर गैर शेर या नस्र के हवाले से जाने या शेर शोहन गैस के हवाले से जाने या कई चांद सर आसमान के हवाले से.
मैं मुझसे क्या पूछ रहे हो, जो भी अच्छा लगे पढ़ो. ये मैंने तो ये लिखी नहीं है बात, किताब जब लिख दी हो जब सामने आ गई तो किताब आपकी हो, आप पढ़े उसको मेहरबानी है, ना पढ़े आपकी मेहरबानी है, तीन किताबें रखी हुई जोर सी रखनी पढ़िए, लेकिन ये किताब को फाड़ के फेंकिए नहीं, तो जलाइए नहीं, दो काम मत कीजिए।
But apart from your larger than life reading page, you are getting promoted now in the last book, whether it's Sabha or whether it's Satya, you have to ask the answer. Kahi chance rahe aapki. Aap aaj hi us cheez ko mante ho.
यार ये तो जो क्वेश्चन जान का है, जान से जो है बहुत बैक टू अरिस्टॉटल, मैंने लिखा भी है कि मैंने एक्चुअली ये बात नहीं कही थी, मैंने ये कहा था और उसको अभी बताया कि कुछ चीज़ें ऐसी हैं जो सिर्फ पोएट्री कर सकती है, जो कि प्रोज नहीं कर सकती, फिक्शन नहीं कर सकता, जो कि बड़ा मेरी विद्यालय थी, ये मीर के बड़े शहरों में नहीं है, लेकिन जो उसमें मीनिंग्स हैं, जितने उसमें लेयर्स हैं, वो कोई प्रोज नहीं कर सकता उसके बाद। प्रोज फिक्शन हमेशा अकेजन पर होता है, आपसे मेरी मुलाकात हुई, आपसे बातचीत पैदा हो गई, मैंने कभी भी नहीं कहा कि आप नॉवल बहुत खराब थी, मैंने ये कहा है मेरी वजह से लोगों ने उसको नॉवल नहीं होगी, क्योंकि हमारे यहाँ बहुत गहरा शॉर्टेज था, मैंने कहा भाई नॉवल लिखो फिक्र थी, नॉवल लोग लिख रहे हैं, खराब लिख रहे हैं, सर लिख रहे हैं, जानते हैं, so I always said the fiction is capable of certain things which poetry cannot, analyzing the human mind, trying to enter the human mind and see what is happening there, trying to understand the various motivations. मैंने कहा दासना से मेरे घर जान पाँच और मैंने लिखा है उनके यहाँ ये कन्वेंशन नहीं था, उसने अपने दिल से पूछा, उसने अपने दिल में कहा, मेरे दिन तो और उसे पूछा, तो सोचना इज समथिंग विच हैपन हियर. So the fictional writer tries to, and sometimes succeeds also, in getting into behind the forehead, and see what's happening in the brain. So ये मैं कभी भी नहीं कहा, लेकिन ये बात सही है कि भाई अब अभी होता ही है ना, जो दिन तो आज आज ही भी कर बनाएंगे, शेर में तो लोग एक स्टोरी से अंदर आ जाते हैं, वन पोएम मेक पीपल विल फॉर ऑल टाइम ऑल मोमेंट, क्या मालूम हमारा ही हाल हो जाए, मुझे फिक्शन के बारे में कोई धोखा नहीं है. कपड़ों का और जेवरों का और भाई तो मैंने कहा कि आँख होना चाहिए देखने के लिए, और नहीं है
जो या हमें तबाह कर देंगे तो जाने कौन पड़ेगा? I know 100% लोग जो हैं वो जवान बड़ा है, जो भी जवान बड़ा है, सब लोग ये कहते हैं।
मुश्किल है तो मुझे उर्दू वाली मिली।
अब देखिए जो आप इस कर रहे हैं वो तो अंग्रेजी में करेंगे, उर्दू में करेंगे, अगर आगे ही उर्दू है तो अंग्रेजी के अब लोग कहते हैं बड़ी मुश्किल है वो आगे ही बस ओपन नहीं बोला नहीं मिलेगा आपको तो ऐसा नहीं देखिए अंग्रेजी में आई हैव ट्राइड टू दैट एज फेयरफुल एज ब्लू एज आई कुड बी Right, but there have been other things I have done. For example,
actually, I think sometimes the English for us is really important. There are occasions like that, especially when he is, when I read it, I can actually see it in my composing that sentence really. It's brilliant. So the English can be appreciated for what it is. You know, we don't have to compare it to Urdu. It's almost like people have said, he's written two books, not one. And then there is the Hindi one as well, so, you know.
It's not
tough.
No, it's just
yeah, I think she's talking about translations merely like a narrative of loss. There are games alongside the human body. But you
can. से पहले हमारी पैदाइश से अब पैदाइश तो अब क्या हो रहा है कि क्या उर्दू सिर्फ मुस्लिम घरानों में से जुड़ कर रह गई है
क्यों रह गई है भाई हिंदू लोगों ने तो छोड़ जाकर रह गई है ऐसा कुछ नहीं है ऐसा कुछ नहीं ये लोगों ने हर जबान पर हर कल्चर पे अच्छे बोलना चाहिए And I don't want to go into all that. I'm extremely embarrassed. लेकिन ये ऐसा कहना गलत है कि उर्दू से मुसलमानों में हो करेगी है और मैं कितने लोगों को जानता हूँ जिन्होंने उर्दू सीखी है जो महाराष्ट्र में जिनकी मदर टंग मराठी है या गुजराती है या बंगाली है या यूं कन्नड़ और मलयालम है जिन्होंने उर्दू सीखी है जब ये हमको उर्दू में जारी है ऐसा नहीं
आप
सही कह रहे हैं मैं पंजाबी समझ लेता हूँ अरबी इंडली पढ़ूँगा ईयर और अगर जल्दी ना बोली जाए तो बंगाली समझ लेता हूँ और पढ़ने का मामला ये कि अगर वो फारसी रखूँ सब में फारसी लिपि में क्योंकि वो पंजाबी है मैं पूरी पढ़ लेता हूँ समझ ले लेता हूँ तो वहाँ की पंजाबी में हम फारसी के वर्ड बढ़े जा रहे हैं बढ़ाए जा रहे हैं तो उनको अपने को यहाँ से अलग करना जो अलग है नहीं लेकिन अलग करना है क्या करना सिंधी का भी हाल है सिंधी अलग एंग्जाइटी आपकी खुद सही है लेकिन इस एंग्जाइटी के जवाब आप ही को देना पड़ेगा कि आप सिंधी लिखिए ऐसी लिखिए जैसे कि वहाँ उस जमाने में लिखी जा रही थी दोनों आदमी एक थे अब हम लोग अलग अलग हो गए हम कहते हमारी पंजाबी में तो अरे लोगों ने तो कहीं हमको एक जमाना उर्दू राइटर है पंजाबी 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 लिपि में आधे 70% लोग उर्दू के हैं तो कह रहे उर्दू करा बात हो पंजाबी हमारी पंजाबी से उसका बात है बात
की बातें
उर्दू वही लिखो जो तुमको आता है और उसमें अगर कोई जान पूछ लो तो हिंदी पूछ रहा है या बंगाली पूछ रहा है या कोई और मर्जी उसकी मर्जी है हमारी मर्जी नहीं है
I just want to make a comment on this because I'm from Pakistan, I'm from Lahore. And what do you feel about Urdu being more Farsiized. We feel exactly the same about Urdu being Hindiized here. Punjabi जब हम बोलते हैं और जब हम किधर आते हैं Punjabi बोलते हैं वो एक वो हमें और Hindiized Punjabi नजर आता है. So there has been and ये by design Punjabi है उसके साथ इसलिए नहीं हुआ कि जो Urdu है उसके अंदर already एक बहुत एक वो है फारसी का वो उर्दू ने पंजाबी को वहीं अर्बन पंजाबी जो है उसको इन्फ्लुएंस किया है बिकॉज वहाँ अर्बनाइज हुई है पंजाब से और उसी तरह यहाँ हम आके देखते हैं कि यहाँ की जबान भी जो है बहुत से हिंदी के अब वो है इन्फ्लुएंस तो आई थिंक दैट इज द रीजन व्हाई यू फाइंड दीज टू लैंग्वेजेस लेकिन उर्दू मैं अभी भी समझती हूँ कि जो पाकिस्तान में उर्दू बोली जा रही है उसको एक्स्ट्रा उसमें पर्शियन ही आई वो उसी तरह से उसका एक चलन अर्बन था अरबी जो उसको अब बुलाया जा रहा है कि खुदा की जगह खुदा हाफिज़ कह रहा है कि आपको इनकरेज किया जा रहा है 10 साल से अल्लाह हाफिज़ किया जा रहा है उसको हम रेजिस्ट कर रहे हैं कि ये चीज़ तो वो अरबी आइज वो एक स्टेट का एक या एक और जो दूसरा है वो मैं देखो
बिल्कुल
Okay, we have now, we run out of time. I think it was a really nice discussion as well afterwards. It's basically your sunny points of view actually on the language and the subcontinent. You're free to carry on, I mean, argue around, I think, and you're free to meet and chat with me. We have to break up the event, but so thank you all for coming.